Homework and Dreams. Winona McQuaid was finishing up after doing the dishes when Latane returned from across the street. Jake was bouncing his young twins on his knees to the rhythm of Roy Acuff, singing a soft country song on the radio called You're the Only Star in My Blue Heaven. The twin boys were about a year old. They had awakened when Jake went into his bedroom to change into a clean pair of long underwear for the evening. Today folks sit around watching their high-definition plasma TVs, but back then they sat around and listened to the radio. Although war was on the horizon in Europe during this post-depression era in 1937, most Americans were feeling positive that the economy had improved. The average family income was around $150 a month. A new car cost $760. A loaf of bread was 9 cents and a gallon of milk was 50 cents. This was the year that saw the opening of the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. The world would witness the explosion of the Hindenburg airship 2 months later on May 6th, when NBC radio announcer Herb Morrison went to New Jersey to do a routine voiceover for a newsreel. His broadcast would become an emotional, on-the-scene description of a calamity nobody expected. Most U.S. airships of the time were already using helium, a byproduct of natural gas, to stay airborne. But hydrogen was 10 to 20 times less expensive. One-third of the world's helium reserves are located in Texas. Using hydrogen for air travel was still considered safe in German Zeppelins before that event occurred. 35 of the Hindenburg's 97 passengers and crew were killed, as well as one member of the ground crew. Later that same year, on July 2, 1937, America would learn the fate of Amelia Earhart as radio broadcasts throughout the world announced that her aircraft was lost somewhere over the vast Pacific Ocean during her final attempt to fly around the world. The majority of Americans had not yet fully embraced the notion of whatever can go wrong will go wrong. However, apart from an inordinate amount of luck or divine intervention, history and Murphy's Law tend to support the idea. It would take another world war, Hitler's Holocaust in Europe, nuclear proliferation, and the advent of the Cold War in the following generation to mark any turning point toward the end of America's Age of Innocence. Robert Redford was born in 1937, as were Bill Cosby and Mary Tyler Moore. FDR was still president and doing radio talks. Walt Disney was having great success with his new animated production of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. It was even in color. Radio in the 1930s had the impact that TV generates today. Over 80% of the population had at least one radio, and millions had radios in their cars. On January 25th, The Guiding Light debuted on NBC Radio, sparking the popularity of daytime soap operas. Judy Garland sang on a live show every week or two on CBS Radio, and March 14th marks the beginning of a new comedy series starring Jack Benny and Fred Allen. The Amos and Andy Show continued to get good ratings, and NBC Radio featured Drew Barrymore's grandfather, the legendary stage actor John Barrymore, in his production of Shakespeare's Taming of the Shrew. There were also a number of crime dramas and popular westerns like The Lone Ranger being broadcast regularly on radio. But on this night, Jake and Winona were simply enjoying their favorite music. Latane scooted up on the arm of her daddy's big chair and leaned her head on his shoulder. She was still thinking about her visit with Glenn. She reached over to pat one of her baby brothers on the belly and laughed as she removed the other one's pacifier. Then, just as quickly, she put it back in his mouth, causing him to giggle. Jake asked his daughter, "Sugar, do you have any homework you need to do tonight? It's getting kind of late." Latane remembered her last class assignment and ran to collect her geography book and a piece of paper. Then she took a seat at the kitchen table and began to trace the outline of a map of Texas. "What are the most abundant natural resources in the region of Texas where we live?" Latane read the first question at the end of chapter 12 aloud, hoping for a quick answer from her mom or dad. Jake answered, "We've mainly got a lot of oil and natural gas under the ground here. If not for that, your nice new school wouldn't have been built, and you'd be doing your lessons somewhere else besides here in New London." Winona turned her head and gave Jake one of those looks that told him to be a bit more serious. Then she explained to Latane, "Your daddy's right, sweetheart. Oil and gas are indeed our greatest mineral blessing in this area. But there's also cotton, lumber, water, farmland, and cattle." Latane made a note on her paper under the map that she had now divided into separate regions and decided that she liked math better than geography and English class better than either of those. She began looking through her book to find the answers that would complete her assignment while the twin boys fell asleep on their daddy's lap in front of the radio. Jake told his wife, "I wish Clemmy and Dee were here right now. We could play a game of dominoes. I don't think I ever had more fun than watching Dee when he gets mad at Clemmy for playing against his hand." A big grin spread over his face. "I bet there are already a few dents in the walls of their new house in Talco from him slamming his dominoes off the table." Winona responded by saying, "I sometimes feel bad for Clemmy when he does that. She doesn't seem to mind, though, and just laughs it off." "I've never seen a man get so worked up over a game," mused Jake. "One time we were playing three-handed moon, and Clemmy got way behind. Instead of getting upset about it, she said a little prayer out loud for Jesus to help her out. On the next bid, she shot the moon and won the game." Dee was holding his last domino and slammed it down on the table so hard it split in half. Dee said he was not going to play with her if she had to pray to win. "I thought I was going to die laughing." "Of course, that was the last game we could play until we got ourselves a new set of dominoes." Winona folded her dish towel, laid it on the countertop, and said, "It's too late to start anything new tonight, honey. I've got a big day tomorrow with the PTA meeting and all. The boys are apt to wear me out when I have to take care of them away from the house." Winona picked up one of the twins and motioned for Jake to follow her with the other one to put them back in their bed. When she returned to the kitchen, Winona asked Latane if she needed any more help with her homework. Latane had just laid her head on her book and looked up at her mother with sleepy eyes. Winona could see the young girl was done for the evening. She carefully escorted Latane to bed and decided to call it a night. Winona McQuaid would later recall how blessed she felt that night, having her husband by her side and all of their beautiful children safely tucked in for a good night's rest. If there were any crickets chirping in their house that night, no one seemed to mind. On that same night, Billy and Holly were snuggled safely in their beds, but they were having nightmares about deadly snakes. They knew that long after this lucky St. Patrick's Day was over, those poisonous vipers would still be slithering just below the surface of the water where the boys had been splashing and swimming without a care in the world. Billy would wake up the next morning wishing he lived in Ireland.